Khyber Pass, Central Asia. A mountainous 25-mile strip, fiercely disputed by armies during the last 4,000 years. Beyond the imaginary Durand line drawn by the British in the 19th century lies a forbidden and forgotten land called Afghanistan. A place where we are still required to cover ourselves from head to toe by wearing medieval garments known as burqas. A country whose government prohibits filming any living beings. A nation ravaged by two decades of civil war with massive human rights violations. A place where we live the daily terror of public executions, abductions, and rape. A land so cursed that Muslims believe it to be the place where Allah dumped the remains of creation. The only way to stop this bloodshed is to give poison to every Afghan. Death is better than this life. Yes, suicide is much better than this life. What is the use of this life? What is the sin of the people of Afghanistan? Are the people of Afghanistan guilty of something? Then the United Nations and the human rights organizations should drop an atom bomb on the people of Afghanistan and kill us all. We were forced to become faceless, to become nameless, to go underground in order to survive our ordeal. But we are stubborn. We will not give up. We don't want to live behind veils. We want a free Afghanistan. This is our story. Najima, a six-year-old girl, spends her time playing with her only toy, dust. Dust is all that remains of our country after thousands of years of war. From the time of Alexander the Great to the British-Russian rivalry in the 19th century, Afghanistan has always been subject to foreign invasions and interference. We have never been free to run our own affairs. In the Cold War period, our country was invaded by the Soviet Union. Afghan rebel forces called Mujahideens fought against the invaders. At that time, the United States and Pakistan started to arm and support fundamentalist Afghan warlords in the hope that they would help them to secure the transportation routes for Central Asia's oil and natural gas reserves.
We haven't been in peace since the Russians and others came to Afghanistan. The people of Afghanistan burn on fire 24 hours a day. We spend night and day in grief. We haven't seen a good time in our whole life. The immigrants have no good memories since the revolution started. Because of homelessness, they are forced to work in other people's land. It is better for us to die rather than living like this. We want death from God, but He is not giving us that either. We haven't seen that kind of life, nor have we heard of it. The wrath of God has been revealed on the people of Afghanistan.
We left Afghanistan because of Masood. He violated the honor of people, raped their wives and daughters. He burned the houses of innocent and poor people. And after that, Taliban came and they committed the same crimes. When we left Afghanistan, we felt that we would be homeless forever. Everyone who got the power in Afghanistan committed crimes and violated our soil. They have made people homeless and vagrant. I am not just talking about myself. The majority of Afghan women have become hungry, thirsty, and widows. After the Soviet withdrawal in 1992, a feeble accord among the fundamentalists did not hold for long. The country was then plunged into total chaos and destruction. The capital, Kabul, was repeatedly shelled and reduced to rubble. Human rights violations became a tragic routine. Women suffered most. I became a widow when I was 20 years old. One of my children cried every time and asked about his father. I also started crying with him. I had no other way. These two kids were my whole life. My eyes were focused on the door, and every minute I anticipated my husband coming back. But Gubuddin did not let anyone be alive. He is a cruel dog. All of them are alike and worse than the other one. In 1996, one of the fundamentalist factions, the Taliban, took power in a particularly brutal fashion, vowing to cleanse the country, especially the cosmopolitan centers like Kabul, of sin and moral degradation. They started a reign of terror marked by public executions, the cutting off of hands, and public beatings of women.
Sahibi gelir Ayzacığım.
Women had jobs and a normal life. Taliban came in their vehicles and stopped women on the street. If she was beautiful, they put her inside the vehicle and take her for their enjoyment. And if she was old like me, they would beat her with lashes and beat her so much that a crowd gathered to watch the scene. After the Soviet troops withdrew from Afghanistan, the wild beast came through the door. They carried me and all women with themselves. Each of them took turns for pleasure with us and did whatever they liked, including beating and raping. After 1 month, I escaped and ran to my house, but it was destroyed and my parents were dead. I asked help from a commander. He gave me strength by saying he would introduce me to a very good lady. But she sold beautiful young girls and women to commanders. I was sold to one of them. He used me in different ways. I tried to run away, and I even thought about committing suicide. The Taliban prohibited us from working, studying, and to appear in public without a male relative. We are also forced to use burqa, this suffocating garment that covers our body from head to toe. When Taliban wanted to take my son and were pulling him from one hand and I was pulling from another hand, I felt that it was better to die. I was thinking about committing suicide, mainly because of hunger, Taliban, and their inhuman oppression. I would rather die than to let anyone beat my son with sticks and lashes. The fundamentalists also imposed upon us burda, which means curtain. We are secluded from the public sphere and confined to home tasks. Since there were more than 300,000 widows in the country due to war, they could not earn a living. Many of us were forced into begging and prostitution.
Because of all of these restrictions and also because of 20 years of war in Afghanistan, most of the women, especially young girls, they were forced to commit suicides. And also women in Afghanistan, because only in Kabul there are 50,000 widows. So now for women, the Taliban banned working outside. For those widows, the only way to survive is begging on the streets or going to prostitution or committing suicide. These are the three options for most of the widows and even for most of the Afghan women.
When my husband was killed, I found myself in a very bad situation. In spite of wearing burqa, these dishonorable and unchaste Taliban stopped me from working and finding a morsel of bread. They were saying that women should not get out of their houses. My children were hungry at home, and they didn't allow me to open a bakery. My children were too small and couldn't work. I started begging just to feed my children. The Taliban beat me with lashes. They beat thousands of other women as well. The Taliban also imposed a ban on music and television, considered to be a devil box. TV sets and audio cassettes are executed and hanged in public places to create fear. However, The worst blow on us was the ban on women's education. The fundamentalist decrees on this matter found an echo in the rural areas, which held a more conservative view on the role of women in society.
Woman is not for education and school. She's only for household chores. We are Muslims, and our religion does not accept that women go outside the house, market, or school. She should always be at home and do housework. It is not right that women without wearing a veil go here and there, and every strange male watches her. We do not accept such things. Those who are in favor of these things have their own choice, but for us, it is completely unacceptable.
As the economic conditions of the country deteriorated, 6 million Afghanis fled the unbearable combination of repression and starvation, becoming the largest group of refugees in the world today. They live in camps at the Iran and Pakistan borders. With few possessions like a skinny parrot and faded photographs spread on a carpet, they still prefer to remain refugees rather than returning to the horrors of the fundamentalist warlords. These criminals, Gubuddin, Masood, and Dustin, have destroyed our country. They have killed young people, abducted young girls, and raped 12-year-old girls. They have murdered women who have had 9 children and made us poor and miserable. Curse on Masood. Curse on Gubuddin, Dustin, and the Taliban, who are busy cutting off hands of people. I know a lady who has 9 children and has to beg in the city. For how long will we have to beg in the streets? Afghan refugees also include a countless number of orphans who cannot forget the memories of war. One day, while my mother was cooking, some fundamentalists entered the house. I had an elder sister, and they wanted to take her by force. My father tried to stop them, and they killed him. Later on, my mother got mental problems and started acting like a mad person. My uncle brought me here. I have no news of my mother. I don't know whether she is alive or dead. Forced to become faceless and nameless in a destroyed country, we did not lose our pride and fighting spirit. Eluding the religious police, we resist by struggling for civil rights and education. We have a network of 2,000 women operating inside the country. One of our main tasks is to provide education for girls in secret home-based schools, considered by the Taliban to be the gateways to hell. The main reason why I work here as a teacher is because in Afghanistan there is no ground available for females' education. At this school, we want to bring up students for the future of Afghanistan. Schools are not available because the Taliban and the fundamentalists don't want the children to learn and think. That is why they closed the schools in Afghanistan. For the sake of giving opportunity for the girls to study, we have made this school so that today's generation will not be deprived of education, and we will try our best to do whatever we can for them. My name is Sadiqa. I am a student of class 8. I am studying so that I can learn something in the future and know about my own people and motherland. There are no schools in our country, and the few that exist are low standard and teach only religious subjects. In our country, women are not allowed to study, to become doctors or teachers, so they give nothing to women as their rights. I want the right to understand and learn something so that I could be in the position to serve my people in the future. I want to know good things. Destroyed, oppressed. Kabul, the former cultural capital of Central Asia, has been transformed into an apocalyptic theme park. Facing great danger, we document public executions so that the world may know about human rights violations.
وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث آخر
مخلوق أصوات زمین أصوات آسمان رابط أكبر تمام كائنات لهذا النظام أبدا
Traumatized, forgotten, alone, Najima is still playing with dust. Thinking of her and thousands of other Afghan girls, we struggle to provide them with a future in a free society, away from veils and segregation.
My dreams for Afghanistan, for my country, to see it a peaceful, a democratic and country like other countries in the world, where women, including myself, have freedom to move around, to go to school, to go to universities, to listen to music, to watch TV, to play what kind of sports they want to play in a country with a lot of scientific in political accomplishments, a country which people and I can proud of having that kind of country and the world and other people. It's not a country in war. I want a country with peace, with security, with freedom, with democracy for all its people, including women.
I want to be free in the future. I want my children to live in a free atmosphere. Every Afghan should live according to her own choice. I want freedom throughout my miserable country. I want to see widows who are not in a position to feed their small children have the right to work. As the other people in the world are enjoying their lives and happy, we also wish to be happy and live a better life. Our country has been destroyed, but nobody has cared. We want to be out of burqas like other people in the world.